Hi, I'm Shalini Bharadwaj. You all are watching ITV Networks Medically Speaking. As India is in the grip of second COVID-19 wave, there is a strong evidence that it spreads through airborne. This is the study which has been done by the Lancet and a panel of scientists that has recommended India to limit their gatherings. We have with us on our panel to discuss about COVID-19 second wave, Dr. Rakesh Mishra, who is the director of CSIR CCMB, Dr. Ishu Gilada, who is a consultant in HIV and infectious diseases, Dr. Geeta, who is a senior surgical oncologist from Max Hospital, and Dr. Alok Thakkar, who is the head of the department ENT from All India Institute of Medical Sciences. Welcome all to Medically Speaking.
Thank you.
My first question goes to Dr. Rakesh Mishra. Sir, as you have done a lot of research, and CCMB and CSI has earlier also done research that whether COVID-19 is airborne or not. Again, this question has been, you know, the Lancet has given their study and given some points, near about 10 points that reveals that yes, it is a airborne. What you would like to say about it?
Yeah, as you said, we knew about this. In fact, last year, there were 2-3 very high quality biophysics papers in which they estimated the size of the droplet in which the virus travels. And it turns out that the virus was traveling in less than 5 micron size, so which means it is can stay in air for a longer time. And so we had taken up a study at that time, which was was made public in January, mid-January sometime. This study was done in Hyderabad and also in Chandigarh in collaboration with the Indian Institute of Microbial Technology, IMTEC, a CSIR lab. And our finding was that if you are in a closed environment, that means there is no airflow, and there are COVID patients in that environment, virus can hang in air for quite some time and can reach up to 20 feet distance. And another finding was that if a COVID patient has gone and used the toilet and flushes the toilet, comes out and closes the toilet, even after 2 hours, you can see the in the air, you can see the virus. C means we have been sampling the air and then going and taking in the lab and detecting the virus. We have also said, so which means if you are using public toilet, you must keep your mask on all the time. Don't think that there's nobody there, but virus is there, because if somebody has used, who was having the infection even an hour or 2 hours ago, the virus may be still around.
That means a person also can catch a virus.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what I mean. And even if the person is in a big apartment, in the room, in the bedroom, or in the living room, or in the kitchen, we have found the virus. If the person is not wearing the mask and talking using the phone, but if the person is talking but keeping the mask on, then we don't find the virus. So all those studies, essentially, we had given an advisory that don't get clustered in a closed environment where there is no air flow. By the way, we never found virus in the open air, in the corridors and so on. So that's why we recommended that there should be negative pressure in COVID wards so that virus doesn't come out, because it can float in air for quite some time. And by the way, even WHO has issued an advisory that 80%, 90% of the infection is through person to person through air, and actually 10-15% is by touching the surface and taking the virus from there. So all these things put together tell us that virus can hang in air for half an hour or more, particularly if there is no air flow around. And therefore, if person comes and goes and then you don't remove your mask immediately, because you do not know the virus may be hanging around, so you have to keep the wear. And most important, that if you wear the mask, you can do two things. You don't let your virus go out, it prevent, and also of course virus doesn't get into you. So if the two people are wearing mask, you are pretty safe. And Lancet study essentially says that, and they also detect in the air duct and AC ducts and the UV effect and those sorts of things. Yeah, but it's it essentially says that we have to be careful of not clustering in closed environment like restaurants, bars, cinema halls, classrooms, and some of these things which we have ignored, and that's why we are in this situation in this second or third wave, whichever place you are.
Sir, what exactly is aerosols and what is droplets? What is the difference? Because there's a lot of confusion to understand this.
These are just, when we are talking, when I'm talking in front of my computer, so the air is coming from my lungs, and that's how I'm making the sound. And so that means air is coming out. Along with air, some moisture is coming out, what is from the surface of my alimentary canal and mouth cavity and so on. And when the air comes out from the surface, it also picks up the water and makes little droplets of the water. Droplets can be of many size. If it is 10 micron or more, then those droplets will not hang in air for a long time. They will, in the effect of gravity, they will fall on the surface in my computer, in the book and person, table, chair, railing, wherever I am. If it is less than 5 micron in size, then it's so tiny that it can hang and play with the air for longer time and it will not fall. It's like a balloon. If you feel that, it will take much more longer time to fall, because its weight is very little. And similarly, the small size droplets, then they become, it's not exactly the aerosol, but it is something closer to that, so that it can hang in air for half an hour or more. And that creates a situation that somebody came in your office, or somebody went in some office, it was, let's say somebody came and cleaned your office without mask. You go there after 10 minutes, if the person was infected, you will catch the infection, there's a possibility. So you have to wear mask only after 1 hour, 2 hours, or you let the window keep open and air exchange, and then it is safer. So that's what it suggests.
So do you think, sir, that we can say that, you know, it is in the aerosols? Can we say this?
Yeah, we can, for practical purposes. So one thing, Shalini, I have noticed during this pandemic is that we focus more on the jargons and not on the really the issues. Like what is the variant, what is the infectivity, what is the efficacy of vaccine, what is the aerosol? None of these, common sense is that for all these things, is vaccine there, take it. Just don't worry so much about it. There
That's
are people
important, who, sir. You're 100% correct, yes.
Yeah. When there is a virus, whether it's which variant, X, Y, Z, there's one way of stopping this virus, that is your mask. It doesn't matter. That virus is not a bullet or bomb. It is a virus. Only when it enters in your body, then it will show which variant it is. Let's not let it enter. That is the simple solution. And third thing is, just now you said that it is, as I said, it can hang around the small droplets of 5 micron or less, can be in the air for longer time. And therefore, you have to keep the mask or avoid clustering places. True aerosol is that it can be there for very, very long time. And there is a debate, though that becomes actually the matter of semantic, whether it's aerosol or not true aerosol. A physicist will say not true aerosol, a biologist or medical person will say, yeah, it is like an aerosol because it's there hanging for longer time. Mm-hmm. But for common person, be aware that if somebody has spoken, gone around, then if the person had infection, there will be virus in there for some time, unless you switch on the fan and let the draft go in and get the air clean.
Dr. Alok, sir, my question to you is, sir, that there are a lot of people who are testing negative and still they have COVID. Why this is happening, sir?
Well, the test is not 100% sensitive, as we say. So sensitivity means that how many of the tests actually pick up patients with the illness. So it is not 100% sensitive. It can happen that you may get a test which is negative. Also, what often happens is that the test is done too early. So generally, if you get an exposure, it takes 5-7 days after which you can get a positive test. If you do a test too early, then naturally it comes negative, and then the patient can become symptomatic or can develop the disease a little bit later. So there are both these aspects.
So there are both aspects.
I can just add.
But it's not usual. I mean, it's not usual for you to get
one in five. Test. We can say one in five are going through this problem, and they are complaining that, you know, after getting thrice or four times, then they got to know that they are positive.
Dr. Mishra, want to say something?
Yes, Dr. Mishra.
Dr. Thakur said that was very correct, that the sensitivities of, I assume you are talking about the RT, which is the most sensitive one.
RT-PCR, yes, sir.
70-80% sensitivity test. So that's in a normal situation also, you are going to miss 20% or even 25% of the, and you will going to give false negative. Keep in also in mind that is more than a year, and our healthcare workers are extremely tired and exhausted. And that your sensitivity of the your test is going to depend on the collection of the swab. If swab is not collected properly, taken more superficially,
that
then you're like
important, right?
So that is going to be there. And then of course there are other factors. The kit may be not good and is performing at 50% of the case. And finally, the worst thing, which is also possible, is that there may be a variant which where the primer site is mutated and you are not picking once in a while. That needs to be established, but there are many other reasons that test might not work. So that's why often it's said that you should test twice negative before you take any major decision of surgery or being out and so on. So, but two times if you test, then most of these things should be eliminated.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Geeta, ma'am, how the basically you are a surgeon, how especially those patients who are cancer patients, you know, they have to undergo certain therapies as well as surgical process also, how these patients are suffering basically during this pandemic, at this time pandemic is explosive.
So, you know, what has happened is that in the process of trying to up the capacity to deal with COVID patients, obviously the other patients suffer. But one must not forget that the other issues are less important. But, you know, a pandemic is an extraordinary situation. And of course, you require to take extraordinary measures. We cannot be complaining. I mean, you know, our heart goes out to the patients that we treat every day. But now we know that it is, you know, the patients have, the number of patients coming to the outpatients has dwindled. And the number of patients we're trying to operate has also gone down. And with all patients requiring an RT-PCR with the RT-PCR reports taking much longer to come in, we are having to postpone cases. And like I said, the capacity for patients who are non-COVID has really gone down. So in a 40%, it's I think it's almost up to 80% now. And there is really very little room for other diseases, like you said, cancer, whether it is stroke, or whether it
is becoming more vulnerable.
So obviously they are, because, you know, you cannot, you know, more people die of cancer than they do of COVID. But, you know, in the kind of situation that we are in, it is hard to think of anything else other than catering to this COVID population. Rather unfortunate. A lot of it is our own making. And I always say, you know, the only thing that you have to do is to just take care of yourself. The rest, everything takes care of by itself. You take care of yourself, you mask yourself up properly, you do the little things that you need to do, like social distancing and using a sanitizer or washing your hands frequently. Just small things for yourself. And unfortunately, we failed ourselves. And in the process, we have failed the rest of the country.
That's true. We all are blaming basically a double mutant variant, but who is responsible? Responsibility was, it is all about, you know, social vaccines. That is very important. It literally plays an important role, and we are doing these things since a year. Dr. Gilada, sir, my next question to you, sir. Sir, what is the use of this remdesivir? And there are a lot of injections that they are not available. Do you think they are literally effective?
No, you see, this is a virus, and there is no perfect antiviral for this COVID virus up till now. The only thing which works is oxygen and steroid, and they have unbeatable experience. Now, tocilizumab, itolizumab, remdesivir, they are all experimental drugs. Among them, remdesivir is better in a sense that it can reduce your hospital stay by 2 to 3 days.
But it cannot reduce mortality, right, sir?
Yeah. It cannot reduce mortality or it cannot prevent death. So, but because it is only for 5 days to be given, is not very expensive. Therefore, people are trying. And there is a saying, "Dard ka marta kya nahi karta." So when they it comes to patient, they will say, "Whatever you want to do, please do it." And therefore, they are doing. Again, it works only during the 7 to 10 days of infection. It doesn't work after that. So it works only in medium or highly advanced cases. It doesn't work in the mild cases. So we need to decide when to use, how to use.
This is
currently what is happening. Currently what is happening, as soon as patient tests positive, sometime on their own or sometime on the advice of their doctor, they go for CT scan. The moment they go for CT scan, there'll be some damage will be there, maybe 6 point, 7 point out of 25. And the doctor will tell them that your 1/3 lung is gone. So you get admitted. The patient goes for admission. They say that there are only 2 or 3 ICU beds available. Get into ICU bed. Patient gets into ICU bed. They say, start remdesivir. And they will start. If they don't start, then they say that now there is no purpose for you to stay in hospital. So go away. So for that purpose, also patients say, okay, whatever you want to do, do it. And remdesivir is a antiviral drug, which was initially tried in hepatitis C, was not successful. It was tried in other 2-3 infections. It was not successful. It is repurposed for this. And currently, Gilead is the only patent owner company which has given a voluntary license to 7 companies. And 7 companies are manufacturing. In between, it was enough stock and they could not manufacture more. So they asked government to buy. And government said, we don't want to buy because there were not many cases. So they were exporting. And then now government said, you cannot export. And the production is also null. So some of the ingredients which are required called API, acute pharmaceutical ingredient, some of them are getting from China. China is not supplying. So suddenly you want to increase the supply of remdesivir is not possible. And government of India can issue a compulsory license to any other pharmaceutical companies in India who can make it. So that the acute shortage which is created, it will not be there. Black market which is created, it will not be there. And the cost of procurement can come down to 400 or 500 rupees per vial rather than it is currently 1,000 rupees or so. And they are selling for 5,000, 8,000, whatever MRPs are there. Maharashtra government has regulated it, but more you regulate, more black marketing. Because there's a huge gap between MRP. So there's a huge gap between a procurement cost or a Maharashtra government has given a cost of 1100 to 1400 and MRP of one drug is, of one company is 5,400. So then they are likely to make black market.
That's true, sir. Dr. Thakkar, sir, if somebody gets positive, what should be the prescription exactly? Because people are worried that, you know, their CT value is 16, their CT value is 17. What should be the exact prescription which is need to be given to the patient?
So this is obviously to be decided by the doctor in terms of what exactly is wrong with the patient at that moment in time. But in general, the initial prescription is entirely towards lowering of the fever and the pain that the patient is suffering. And for that, usually the Crocin or paracetamol is the first line of treatment. If that doesn't work, you go on to NSAIDs. With regard to specific therapy, it has already been said that we don't have very many very specific therapies in this situation, but there are many supportive therapies. And which one to use at which moment in time depends a lot on what the blood tests show. And also depends a fair bit on the perfect stage of the illness. For example, for prevention, we have different drugs, and for the situation wherein there is increased inflammation, we have different drugs. In the early phase of the illness, when the viral may be replicating, we may use remdesivir. But it won't quite be appropriate to give a prescription on the television with regard to what is appropriate for which situation. Different drugs are used in different phases. And of course, they are guided by the situation of the patient and the test as to what they show.
Dr. Geeta, when it is required to get somebody admitted, because, you know, in initial stage and what we have seen, there are a lot of patients who really does not require the hospitalization, but still they wanted to get hospitalization. What you would like to say about it?
I think there is a lot of panic element to this, and especially the elderly with comorbidities, one tends to hit the panic button earlier than later. But then, you know, it is advisable to, because with the kind of rush that you're seeing in the hospitals and the fact that you're really running out of hospital beds, it may still be a good idea to watch them, isolate them at home, do a video consult with a pulmonologist or a physician, and get a preliminary prescription, keep a watch on the vitals, especially the saturation and the fever bits. And if the fever were to be persistent and the saturation were to fall below 94%, you know, these are the times when you need to think about getting the patient into hospital. But, you know, at times it's very difficult because sometimes isolation at home is not possible. And what we're seeing today is that the entire family is getting affected. It's not just one person, because the infectivity this time round is pretty, pretty high.
Dr. Mishra, sir, why this is happening? You know, everyone is worried this time that more and more children, more and more youngsters are testing positive. Why this is happening? Maybe because of the, we can understand that, you know, people were not following the guidelines. They were not following the appropriate behavior, which is the most common and important cause behind it. But what else can be the reason if we talk about the variants?
People are speculating that variants are partially the cause for the high rate of infectivity, and it has been shown, like, for example, the two major variants which are going around in the country. One is the UK variant, which is more in Punjab, 70-80% of the cases, and UK variant is known to be more infectious for two reasons. One, it latches on more strongly to the anchor in the cell surface and to enter in the epithelial cells of the respiratory tract, and it binds to stronger. So even if fewer particles go, some of them will enter the cell. Second thing is, it was shown that patients with this variant produce more virus, so that obviously increases more the infectivity. And that is why in normal condition, if ordinary variant will be spreading, let's say, two people from one person, this may be spreading to 3-4 people, and that as a chain reaction makes big difference. So the UK variant is known for this, and luckily there is no other major aspect to this mortality or a problem with the vaccine. They are not there that have been tested. The other variant which is going around now is what is called B1.617, which is a double mutant, is for wrong reasons called double mutant. But anyway, this variant has two features. One is that one of its signature is known to have a higher infectivity. It was known in California several months ago. And the other mutation, which is more worrisome, is that there's an indication that it may escape the immune system and therefore be more infectious, although that needs to be established. We are culturing this virus in the lab. We found that, and we will know in 10-12 days whether it's really able to avoid the antibodies or not. But having said that, even in this very highly rising wave situation, majority of the cases are not these variants. They are something else, ordinary variants, which we don't even care to know their names. So that means the spread of the virus is primarily because of the behavior of the people, opening up the shop, opening up the mall, opening up the cinema halls, school, restaurant, bar. On top of that, you do marriage parties in the halls, and then the worst is you start doing election and religious activity. I mean, everything is together. And this is where we feel very frustrated that, I mean, all of you know, 800 doctors have lost life in treating these patients.
So true, sir.
So precious to, we can make more beds. We cannot make more healthcare workers with this speed. And as a public, we are responsible. If we wore the mask, if we avoided ourselves, we would have maybe saved maybe 400 of those. So let's not blame the virus. It may be whichever variant, it will do the mischief only when it reaches in your body. and there is a mask in between to put to prevent it from reaching your body, and you can solve the problem. So I think we have to take the issue in our hand and not chase the government and this didn't happen, that didn't happen. Let's do that. What we can do, this is absolutely in our hand that we can stop it. Variants are there, they will be there, and it is a very normal thing. In fact, some time back we did study the 6,000 isolate when we sequence, there were 7,500 variants in that. So you don't want to, it is really not nothing to care about the variant. They will, this is the nature of this virus, that it may vary. Most of the variants are of no consequence. One or two which are there. What is the worrisome to me is that if we keep allowing this virus to play with us, keep spreading to all the near and dear with us, we, and as we know the virus changes, it may happen one day in future that a variant will come that will not care about the vaccine. A variant will come which will be a higher mortality. So we are kind of culturing and screening for those virus which will be more troublesome for one day. So I'm being a little bit emotional and harsh in this, because it is the time for people to take the matter in their hand and take their mask properly, and not wearing the mask is being uncivil. In fact, it is being antisocial, because you are putting the risk of others' life at risk, and they are your own people, your own friend, because you bring from outside and distribute to your friends and your people. And in the end, you are putting extra pressure on the healthcare system, which is in such a stressful situation. 1 year, when we were in February and all, we thought maybe we are getting other side. Suddenly, you see all these things. So we want bed and all, but there are these people who have to take care of you with wearing all the mask and all the PPEs. If you wear PPE and work in the lab for 2 hours, you will know how difficult it is. So I think we have to take the matter, take our responsibility, accept our responsibility, and shun any crowding, stay home, and avoid lockdown if we keep the situation in hand. Otherwise, lockdown will happen, and that is yet another problem, particularly for poorer people. They will suffer. So variant is a something which is really not of importance at this moment for us. Important thing is that we should wear our mask, avoid congestion, avoid clustering in closed places, and keep washing our hands before we do anything at home. And that will be the greatest service we will be doing, and we should make a oath that we will do it this way. And that's the message I think we should all spread. That's the most important thing for us to practice now.
That's really important. Thank you so much, sir. The thing which is important, that is your social vaccine. Stop gathering, stop going outside when it is not required, and stop, you know, panicking the situation. We can handle it. The important thing is that how we are handling it, and we can handle with our behavior. That means it is our social responsibility. We should not stop wearing a mask, social distancing, and sanitizing ourselves. So understand what doctors are saying. It is very important, because right now we are in an explosive state. If you wanted to protect yourself, your family, so please understand and listen to them, what they are saying, carefully. Thank you so much, Dr. Thakkar. Thank you so much, Dr. Ishwar, Dr. Geeta, Dr. Rakesh Mishra, for sharing such a important information when we are going through a big pandemic this time. Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.